Okay, so today is January the 18th, okay? Today we're going to be talking about kinetics. Yesterday we started talking on what causes an effective collision. Okay, what were the two criteria for an effective collision? Okay, so somebody in the back, what did she say? Enough energy to overcome the activation energy, EA. What's the second criteria? Proper orientation. Now, we can't just stop with proper orientation. In years past, that was sufficient. But now we have to specify. Okay? Reactant bonds can begin to break and product bonds begin to form. Okay? Now, sisters, we have you together here now. Okay? Yes, I did notice. Okay? So, you got to prove that you can do this. Okay? Now, so we have to have an effective collision. So what are the four factors that kind of control whether or not it's going to be an effective collision or how to increase the number of effective collisions? Temperature. What does temperature do? Okay? Increases kinetic energy, which? Speeds them up, which? That's the second thing. Okay, the first thing you do is you speed them up. So what does that do? It does increase collisions. Okay, so we want to do that. So it increases collisions, which increases the probability of proper orientation, where reactant bonds can begin to break and product bonds can begin to form. Okay, but what's the second thing that increases the temperature? It gives more molecules at a higher temperature will have sufficient energy to overcome the energy of activation. Okay? Not all molecules, but more molecules as you increase the temperature. Now, the more you increase the temperature, the greater percent of molecules that will have sufficient energy. Okay? But just because they have enough energy doesn't necessarily mean it'll be an effective collision, because it also has to have proper orientation in the collision. So you got to have both criteria met in order for it to be an effective collision, in other words, for product molecules to form. Okay? So that's temperature. What's the second factor? Surface area. What does increased surface area do? More collisions, which increases the probability of having a proper orientation where reactant bonds can begin to form and product bonds can begin to, reactant bonds begin to break and product bonds begin to form. Okay? Third one. Increased concentration. What does increased concentration do? Increase the number of collisions, which increases the probability of having proper orientation where reactant bonds can begin to break and product bonds can begin to form. Okay? And what's the fourth one?
Catalyst.
And what does a catalyst do? Lowers the activation energy to where at any given temperature, then there will be a greater fraction of molecules that will have sufficient energy to overcome EA. Okay? So, we get over the hill by doing one of two ways. We give it more energy, more push, make it go faster, heat them up, speed them up, so the hill's still the same height, but they have more molecules and more energy to make it over the hill. Or we lower the hill so the slow molecules can still make it over. Okay, that's what you guys want me to do on your test. You don't want me to keep the hill high and just motivate you and make higher grades to get over that hill. You want me to lower the standard so the slow people can still get up and over the hill. Okay? Make it flat. Yeah, we want to, maybe a valley. Make it easier. Let gravity work in our favor here. All right. So, then we begin. So those are the factors that determine whether or not, you know, that affect the rate of a reaction. Then we looked at how to actually measure the rate of a reaction. And we measure the rate of a reaction by measuring the change in concentration of either our reactant or a product. How does the concentration vary divided by time? Okay, it's just like a rate is equal to distance divided by time. This is going to be rate is equal to change in concentration divided by time. Okay, so we were going through and looking at those type of scenarios. Now, on Classroom, I gave you notes for all of this, Okay? The National Math and Science Institute, NIMSI notes. And there's a whole section in there on how to, some of this graphing stuff we're going to talk about today, on how to put it in your graphing calculator, and I would just totally ignore all of that. Okay? Because you're never going to have to generate a graph for an AP test. You're never going to have to make one. You are going to have to interpret given graphs, but it's really a simple interpretation, but you're not going to have to generate one. So all that on how to put it into your graphing calculator. Now, if you want to know how, but I think it's probably pretty old, you know, with your new Inspire, it's probably a little bit different. I think it's a TI-83 is what the directions were for. So they probably aren't even valid now. So, but in addition to the notes, I also gave a big packet of practice problems. Okay? Now, so let's start off with the practice problem. Where is my notes of what I want to do today? No, we're going to do them out of the textbook first. I had all the ones I wanted to do written down on a sheet of paper, and now I can't find that sheet of paper because that's how organized I am. Okay, in the white books, 619, I think, is the page.
That is 5 days before my younger brother.
Let's look at actually page 620. Okay, y'all, page 620, and let's look at. Let's look at number 30. Number 30. Number 30. Okay, now I know there's a glare when you guys look at this without the screen, but I need to be able to write on the board. Okay, so number 30 says, the following data were collected for the rate of disappearance of NO in the reaction 2NO plus O2 yields 2NO2. Okay, so when we're looking here then, now again remember, what is the rate law? The only way we can get this rate law, the only way we can get that is how? Well, that's it. We can do the generic form of it. Okay, so for A, we know that rate is going to equal K times what? NO to some power X times the concentration of O2. So what's the only way I can find X and Y? Okay, but what do we call this?
Experimental data.
Okay? The only way you can get the rate law, the true rate law, the X and the Y, the exponents, to find out the order of the reaction is from experimental data. So you have to be given some kind of chart like this. This is our differentiated rate law. Okay? So, now we want to find, okay, so to find X for NO, What do I have to do with O2? Keep it constant. So we look here so we can see experiment 1 and 3, O2 is constant, right? So 1 and 3, so I want to compare. So what happens between 1 and 3 here? Times 2. So what happens to my rate? Times 4, right? Now you can always, since it's the same power of 10 right here, you can ignore that and you can just go this divided by that, and it should come out pretty close to 4. Now remember, it is experimental data, so it doesn't have to be exactly 4. It can be 3.98, 4.05, even 4.1. Okay? It doesn't have to be exact. And by the way, do we say data or data? Yeah, I say data, but a lot of people say data. Okay? Now, yeah. So, all right. So this is times 4. So, just without doing any math, what's the power here? 2, right? So we know it's squared, but we have to show work. So that to show work, what we're going to do is we're going to say for the rate, the change in the rate from experiment 1 to 3, and it's important that you label what experiments you're comparing. So the change in the rate from 1 to 3 is equal to the change in the concentration of NO to the X. So now we simply say 4 is equal to 2 to the X. Does everybody understand and know where those numbers are coming from? And how to get that? Okay? You just have to compare. Now it's real important to kind of, you know which ones to compare because we're keeping one constant. Okay? That's how I knew to compare 1 and 3. So X is obviously equal to 2. So we're going to say it's second order with respect to the NO. Now I want to find out, well, what's my exponent for O2? So what do I have to do here? Find the two that are constant. What experiments? 2 to 3. Now, I'm comparing 2 to 3 here, but since this one's smaller, I want to compare 3 to 2 more than 2 to 3. You can go either way, but I like just making it times 2 rather than times 1/2. It just makes the exponent, the power, a whole lot easier. Okay? So it doesn't matter which way you go. Just make sure you're going the same way both ways. So if this, you know, if you're going times 2 here, it's, you got to go this way as well. Okay? So we're going here. It's going to be times 2. Now note, it doesn't, 5.64 to 1.13. But what's different? The power. So this is really 11.3. If times 10 to the minus 2. Okay? So it's going to be 2. Well, it's times 2. So it's really, the exponent's going to be 1. But, okay, so this is, here, it's times 2. Does everybody see that? Because you got to pay attention to that power. Because sometimes it'll just throw you off. You automatically assume it's the same power over here. So just be aware of that. So if it doesn't look like it's working out right, double check your exponents. Okay, so it's really 11.3 divided by 5.64. Because if you change this to 10 to the minus 2, you make this 10 smaller, you make this 10 bigger. Okay, or you can just plug this whole thing into your calculator and then just divide it out and see what it comes out to. But it's going to come out to 2. So again, we're going to say the change in rate from 3 to 2 is equal to the change in the concentration of the O2 to the Y. So 2 is equal to 2 to the y. So y equals 1. So we say it's first order with respect to O2. What's the overall order going to be? Third order. It's just the sum of the exponents. Yes, sir?
Are you going to have a zero order?
You can have a zero order. Now, what do you think would happen with a zero order? The concentration changes.
The rate
doesn't change. Okay, so if the concentration changes, but then we're going to do the next practice problem we're going to do. Okay, the rate doesn't change, so it'd be zero if you change concentration, but the rate doesn't change. That's zero order because it's times 1. Okay, so 2 to what power? You know, you double the concentration. 2 to what power is equal to 1? 0. Okay, but the key is that if changing the concentration doesn't change the rate. We're going to learn in reactive measurement that, that particular compound is not in what we call the rate determining step. It's not, it doesn't, its concentration, something else is slowing it down. It's kind of like a, relay race, okay? You could have Usain Bolt, you know, running three legs of a four-man relay. And then I'm number four. We're still going to lose, okay? Because I'm slow. I mean, I'm slow. I have to stop and drink a Diet Mountain Dew halfway through, you know? So it's not going to happen. So sometimes in a reaction, a bunch of steps can be super fast and one of them be super slow. And that slow step is called the rate determining step, and it's the one that's going to really determine the overall rate of the reaction. And so if a compound's not in that rate determining step, then it's going to be zero order. So it doesn't matter what the concentration is. That's not affecting the rate. It's not the slow guy. Okay? So, and we'll talk more about that on Monday when I come back. That'll be what we're kind of talk about.
You're going to be gone next week too, right?
Yeah. Thrillsville.
I think
we're going to board a school. Yeah. Okay. So, now, I haven't fully said the answer yet. So now we have the rate law. We have to say, so what is the rate law? The rate law is equal to K times, y'all, come on, NO squared times O2. Now, we don't have to write the 1. If you just don't write anything, it's an understood 1. Okay? It's not wrong to write the 1, but it's generally not written. Okay? So, again, I'm making my curved thing there. So, NO times O2. So, this is my rate law. So, that's the answer to A. But this is the work that you have to show in order to get it. Even though sometimes you can just look at it and see it by inspection, you still have to show this. Now, I like to even show the overall equation just so, especially like a reader would know, okay, I really know what I'm talking about. And if you go through the notes that I put online, they go through and show you how they derive this equation from the full putting the two rate laws of the two experiments together, and then how they kind of cancel out and show the math. But it all boils down to this. There's no need to go to the big long one if we can just go straight to this. We're just comparing how does the change in concentration affect the rate, and we're just isolating it because we're keeping two constant. Okay? So now, once we have our rate law, how do we get K?
Put it over.
Okay. Pick one, anyone, because assuming the K is truly a constant, it should be the same number for all three, so it doesn't matter which one you pick, but you have to use the data all from the same. You can't use this, this, and that. Okay? So you got to use all the same one. So the rate is 1.41 times 10 to the minus 2, and that's molarity per second, is equal to K times 0.0126 molar squared, and unfortunately I didn't give enough room, times 0.0125 molar. So just divide all that out. Now notice, what unit? We're going to get molarity what? Cubed, right? But then when you divide, you got one molarity over here, it's going to cancel out. So it's going to be molarity squared on the bottom. So whatever order it is overall, the molarity is going to be one less. So if it's third order, it's going to be over molarity squared seconds. And always make sure you look at the time. Is it seconds? Is it minutes? Is it hours? Tends to always be seconds, but then they'll throw a minute in there or they'll throw an hour in there and you mess it up. Because every time, if they ask you for K, they're going to ask for units. It's just it's algebra. It's all it is. So what does the actual value of K turn out to be? 7,105. So we really have 3 sig figs, so that would be 7,110. Is it 0.06? So it's right at 5. So we'd round up. So we'd say 7,110. Okay? 7,110. And then the units are going to be where's molarity going to be? On the bottom. So it's going to be per molarity squared times seconds. Okay? I know the iPad's in the way. So now, once we have K, how do we get, now, what is the average value of the rate constant calculated? Well, that means we have to do it all three times and divide by three. We don't need to do all that. Okay, if you can do it once, you can do it three times. Okay? That's where I differ from a math teacher. Let's do 20 of these. Well, it's experimental data. Yeah, so that's why I say get the average value. Okay, now, what is the rate of disappearance? Okay, so notice it says that this is the collective for the rate of disappearance of NO. So now they give you concentrations. So what do we do with that? Just plug it in now to our equation. Now that we know the value of K, you just plug these values in and solve for it. Okay? So that part's super easy.
Can we use the average value?
Well, yeah, technically you would use the average value, but again, they never ask you to do that.
So when it asks for the rate law, you do have to calculate both the orders and K?
No, the rate law is just this. This is the answer to A.
Okay.
Okay? Then, so it's always going to be kind of a two-step thing. Calculate, get the rate law, then what's the value of K with the units? I mean, these problems just come all the same way. Then they give you concentrations to plug it in. Now, here's this. This is a good one right here, though, on E. So notice that it's given here that it's the rate of disappearance of NO. Because when we measure the rate, it's always going to be per one thing. You can only measure one thing, the rate in terms of one thing. It's either going to be the rate of disappearance of a reactant or the rate of appearance of a product. So they've given us, okay, so this is my rate of disappearance of NO. Okay? So here's my equation right here, the disappearance of this. So now the question asks on E, what is the rate of disappearance of O2 at the concentrations given in part D? Okay? So here you get the rate. How is the rate of disappearance of O2 going to compare to this? It's just going to be half as much. This is how they ask a relative rate question. We went and did all the relative rate law yesterday. You don't really ever have to write the relative rate law. Now, here you could do it. So what if we wanted to do the relative rate law here, rate is equal to the change in concentration of O2 over time, which is going to equal what in terms of this? One half of the change in concentration of NO over T. Well, we just calculated in D, if you plugged in the values, we just got this value right here. Because that's the rate at these concentrations of the disappearance of NO. So you would just plug that in, basically you multiply by half, and you could really just look at this if you wanted to show work. You don't even have to write all this out. You just go, okay, well the rate was whatever you calculated in D times one half is going to equal the rate of O2. And that's how they ask the relative rate question. So, it's going to be the same unit, the exact molarity per second. The rate is always molarity per second.
Would it not be negative one half?
Well, they're both negative. They're saying what is the rate of disappearance, so the word itself is telling us the negative. Okay, so again, it's kind of like when we were talking in the last chapter on thermo. If you say heat is released, you don't have to say negative amount of heat released. You don't have to say it's a negative rate of disappearance. Okay, the word itself tells us the direction. Okay, so I wanted to kind of stretch this one out and just kind of let you see how, you know, they ask that relative rate question. And this is a common thing in AP. The thing is, you just have to pay attention whenever I see this question. And that's why I went and double-checked on D, because it said, what is the rate of disappearance of NO? When they specify like that, I went back up and said, well, what did they give me the rate in? Are they changing what the rate is? Because then I have to go to do that, you know, relative rate law. I've got to do the stoichiometry. But this one, D, was the same one. But then E is a different one. So you just kind of specify, look. Okay? Y'all following me on that? Or is it blah, blah, blah? Okay. Everybody kind of comfortable seeing this? Okay. Let's take some time. Now open up your Chromebooks. get the packet. Oh, we don't know. But when you do D, you're finding the rate, and it's going to come out in molarity per second. Well, you just when you plug this in, you already know K. You already is that. So you're finding the rate. So you're finding this rate is equal to, and it's just going to be that's what they're measuring it in. But that's what all these values are here. You're not plugging in a changing. You're not solving the rate this way. You're solving the rate from this equation. Okay? That's why I'm saying this, but when we write just the relative rates, we're just going to compare the rate of one to the rate of other. Just the general formula. Okay? But this is how we actually are solving for the rate. Okay? Now, once you get the... open up the packet of practice questions. Okay? And I either want 2008 or 2009. Yeah. Yeah, 2008 Form B. Open the packet up to 2008 Form B. Okay. See, let's do this one. A through E. No, it's quick. A through E. Yeah, I want you to do it.
Okay, well, what if it's like a blur? Not exactly.
Okay, hey, couple of things. That's why I like this one. Experimental data. This is basically the exact same thing. That's constant. That's within reason. Okay, these two are exactly the same. Okay, so you can assume that the concentration is constant here. So it doesn't have to, as I'm saying, it doesn't have to be perfect as long as it's close. Now, these two are not the same. Okay? But when you're comparing 3.3 to 3.4, that's the same. 3.6 to 3.7, that's the same.
We're missing the 4-4 today. They don't come to the 4-4.
Okay, so I want to find A. So I need to keep B constant. Okay, so here's my constant, so I'm going to compare here. So this is my change in concentration. It's going to be times, what's that, times 4? Okay, so now I come here and I look at my change in my rate. This is actually times 1. So it's going to be change in rate 1 is equal to 4 to the x. No, because that's why you can only have one variable. So that's why we have to find the ones that are constant, because the concentration didn't change, it's not affecting the rate at all. That's why we're choosing those two. Okay, how are we doing over here? You're good?
No,
okay. No questions? Okay. Jump a little sharp. Okay. Hey, Scott. You know what to do? Okay. Okay. Anthony, I think they did it. Per second is going to be molarity, so it's a lot easier if you just change this to a capital M. Okay? However, again, no, not at all. It's the same thing. Okay? So, but again, this is moles per liter. It's just everything's going to, so instead of being M squared or M to the first, it'd be moles to the first, liters to the first. So whatever is on the M is just going to be moles per liter. The same thing. So when we do this, I'll do it. Is everybody pretty much done to that point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's just through E, right?
Yeah, through E. Okay, so we're good?
Yes.
All right, so let's talk then about what we do. So again, I know that my rate, my general equation for the rate is equal to K times A to some power X times B to some other power y. Okay? So, I need to figure out x and y. So I go and I look and I want to find a, so I keep b constant. So these two are constant right here. So I want to compare. I go smaller, so this here, so again it's going to be 34 into 136, that's going to be times 4, right? So I'm going to still compare here, but this is times 1. The rate didn't change. So automatically, what do I know my power is, my exponent?
Zero.
But we still have to show work. Okay? So if you can know what your answer is supposed to be before you do the work, it always helps. Yes, sir?
What about like for like C?
Well, let's just get there. So, okay? So the change in the rate from experiment 2 to 3 is equal to the change in the concentration of A to some power X. So we're going to say 1 is equal to 4 to the x. So x obviously is 0. Now we have to do the same thing for b. so we go for B. Okay? So I need B. So I got to find when is A constant? Well, A is constant between the first two. So again, I look here. And it's the exact same thing, 34 to 137, so this is times 4. This time, now I'm going to go here. Now, again, you always want to notice the power of 10 is completely different. 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 4. So you just have to divide the bigger by the smaller, and this ends up being times 16. So obviously, what, just by inspection, what's the exponent going to be? 2, because 4 squared equals 16. All right? Mr. Reich would be proud of y'all's exponents and your logarithms and being able to. Okay? So our change, we'll just say 4 is equal, 16 is equal to 4 to the y, so y is equal to 2. So my rate law, well, actually, determine the order of the reaction with respect to A. You show all that work right here. So that's where you say, I need to write it the way we want to do it. Change in rate from 2 to 3 is equal to the change in the concentration of A to the X. So you say 1 is equal to 4 to the X. X equals 0. Now, don't just stop right there, because you haven't said yet what the answer to the question. You just did some work. Now you need to prove. So then you just say, what's the question? What determined the order? The order of the reaction with respect to A is 0. Okay? And this is your justification. Or if you wanted to even put it into words, why is it 0 order? What does 0 order mean? Wesley? Well, the molarity changed. What didn't change? The rate didn't change. The order of the reaction with respect to A is 0, because as the concentration is changed, the rate remained constant. And then you show this work right here. Okay? So that's how you put it in words. Okay? So now we do the exact same thing here. So the change in rate from experiment 1 to 2 is equal to the change in B to the Y. And so it's going to end up being change in rate is 16 is equal to 4 to the y. Y is equal to 2. So then in words, you say the order with respect to B is 2, because as the concentration is quadrupled, the rate increases by 16. By a factor of 16. Well, I would just one sentence. Just your work is there. The work probably is enough, but you definitely have to say the order is 2. The order is 0. Okay, because x and equals 0 and y equals 0 isn't telling the reader that you know that that's the order. Okay, you and I know that we know that, but they don't know you, so you have to be clear. All right. So write the rate law. So then the rate law, rate is equal to K times, do we need A at all? It's just going to be B squared. No, as long as you put 0. Okay? In this case, it's hip to B squared. B squared. Okay. Huey Lewis in the news.
That's our show choir song.
Oh, really? Yeah, you got to be old to be able to know that or sing old songs.
We're in shipwreck.
Yeah. Okay, now, to determine the value of K, we just plug in, okay? So now it's going to be easier. So the rate is 6.67 times 10 to the minus 4th. Now, this is moles per liter per second. Now, we should be able to do the math, but it's probably easier just to do molarity per second is equal to K times B squared, which is going to be 0.034 molar squared. So, you got molarity squared here. You have molar here, so what's going to end up on the bottom? Just one molarity, so it's going to be 1 over molarity squared. But that's really going to be, when you divide by moles per liter, what happens when you divide by a fraction? You flip it, right? So moles per liter in the denominator becomes liters per mole, if you just want to put it. So the reality is the units also could be, so what's the actual value? What's the number? 0.57. Okay, we have 3 sig figs all the way through. We only have 2 sig figs right here. So it would be 0.58. Okay? And it would be per molarity times seconds, which is, or you could say 0.58. Molarity is moles per liter, so you could say liters per mole seconds. That's how the units would come out if you didn't change it to molarity. Okay? They come out to liters per mole. Because if molarity is in the denominator, that's moles per liter. What if it was like this other one where it's molarity squared in the denominator? How would that translate to this? If it was molarity squared. Liter squared over mole squared. Okay? So it's super easy. Okay? So, but again, this is always molarity per second. So sometimes it'll be capital M, sometimes it'll be moles per liter, but you can change it to just capital M and it makes the units doing the math a little bit easier. And then lastly, E, calculate this. So how do we find this? Plug it in. So rate is equal to 0.58 molarity times seconds.
Whew.
Yeah.
We got here at 10:40.
We have an hour. We have another 40 minutes.
I know. That's good. We need it. Okay. So times b squared is 0.233. What do we do with this?
Nothing.
Okay. And that's going to be molarity squared. Molarity squared. Okay. Now notice.
I am.
Now look. Look. Molarity's in the denominator. Seconds in the denominator. Molarity squared is going to be in the numerator. So one of the molarities is going to cancel, which is going to leave you with what units? Molarity per second, which is what rate is always measured in. So what is that rate actually equal to?
Okay.
2 sig figs.
3.1
molarity per second.
Even though the
data is 2.
Because your rate, when we found K, it was only 2 sig figs. So K is the limiting factor, not
by 10 to the
negative 2.
Okay,
because K is part of it.
It's 3.1 times 10 to the power negative 2.
What?
10
to the negative 2.
Negative 2.
Yes.
Okay, let's make sure we get it right. Let's not leave that part off. Do everything right and then just get lazy and don't put down the exponent and miss a point. Then it makes me want to just kind of, when I read the pink books, I just want to reach out and... Yes. Why would I get them if I'm not going to look at them? I love being able to do what we did the other day, is going through and analyzing, what do you think? Did this person get it? Did that person not get it?
How did last year do?
Lousy. That's the worst ever. I don't know why. What? So I'm not quite sure why, because I mean it was great group of kids and they worked hard and just the test just didn't match up. Yeah, we had a few, but not as many as I normally have. 41. You only had 3 5s. Normally out of 41 we'd have 12 to 15 5s.
How many passed?
Now I will say though that they've kept raising up, you know, and I had a large number. I had 12 not pass, and that was huge.
Not pass at all.
Well, they got twos.
Yeah.
So. That was rare. I mean, I'm not, and that really kind of stunned me. That's why I'm trying to figure out what I need to change. Okay. Now.
Did my brother pass?
Do what?
Did my brother pass? Not the class, for the exam. He probably didn't pass the class either.
He passed the class. I can't remember what he made on the exam.
What? I don't know.
It probably wasn't super high. Yeah. but I didn't say his name. So, okay. All right. So that is doing problems with the differential rate law. Okay. But if we have a differentiated rate law, that means we also have calculus people. What's the opposite? What's the opposite of take? If you don't differentiate, if you no, you integrate. Who said it? I didn't hear you. You got to speak up. You have the integrated rate law. Okay, now, there's no need for me to get in to try to explain any of the calculus. There are two reasons why I don't need to get into that. Number one, you haven't even learned it yet, so it's just going to be blah, 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 wow. Isn't that cool? The second reason is because I learned it 30 years ago, and I've totally forgotten it. Okay, so I know the basics of it, but to try to explain how we get there, that bread is long molded. Okay, so it's classic use it or lose it. So we don't need to know the calculus. We know that it's derived from the calculus. For those of you that are in calculus, and when you go to college, you will take calculus. You will understand. Oh, that's where they got this equation from. Okay, but when we take this basic rate law, the rate is equal to the change in concentration divided by time, you take the derivative of it, you get the rate is equal to K times the concentration of the reactants raised to a power. If we integrate it, take the integral of it, then you're going to get a different equation. It's just kind of going the opposite direction. And it comes out to equal, and I may need somebody to look this one up to verify that I'm remembering it right. The natural log of A at any given time t is equal to kt plus the natural log of A initial. Okay? Now, if you scroll down to like page 15 in the notes, they have all these integrated rate laws. I actually probably just need, let me see. I need to verify that. I forget which one is the T and the initial, and I get messed up which one is if it's minus or plus.
Oh, I found it. It says it's negative KT.
Yeah. Negative KT plus log?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the good news, see, and the reason why I never worry about this is because it's on your equation sheet. It's always going to be given to you.
Oh, good.
Okay? So you don't have to memorize it. Yeah. Okay, so minus KT. So all we got to do is add in a negative sign there. Oh, this is, well, yes. Okay? It's notes about a new type of problem. Okay? So it's going to be the same type thing, except we're going to use an integrated rate law instead of the differential rate law. Now, what's the difference here? What term does this have in it that the other equation didn't? Natural log, but what is T? Time. So in these cases, you are going to be given an initial concentration and a time. So whenever the data tables in time, that's going to be your clue. That's going to be your ding, 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 your mental, awareness. Hey, I need to use the integrated rate law, not the differential rate law. When you're given the table in concentrations, we do what we just did. But if you have time, then you're going to use this equation. So anything that's related to how much is going to be left after a certain amount of time, anytime time is a factor, this is the rate law you're going to go to. Okay? Both of them are going to be given, but this is the one that you're going to need. So now this is for first order. So you need to know the order of the reaction in order to be able to know which equation to use. For second order, Okay, and almost always they give you the order. But for a second order, no, again, they're given on your equation sheet. You'll always have them. 1 over AT is equal to 1 over, is equal to KT plus 1 over. And KT is the same great law constant plus 1 over A0. And this, when it, by the way, you might make a note on this. This always means initial. When you have the little zero, the like a degree, that means your initial concentration. So this is for a second order. Yes, sir. In my book, I have a T on it.
It doesn't matter. It's just like FX versus, like, the T doesn't matter. Because the T is a variable.
Yeah, you're going to have it in there. So, I mean, it's part of the equation.
But T doesn't matter. That's just like saying FX.
Well, that's your time. No, that's your time. I mean, it's going to be a, yeah.
You already have time on the
right. Right.
The T on the left side doesn't matter. Because you
Are you talking about this T?
Yeah.
Oh, this is just describing at any time T. The concentration at this time T. This is that T. This is just the subscript T. That's just saying that this is the concentration at this time T. I thought you were saying you didn't have this T. I was going to say. No, this little subscript T just simply means that this is the concentration initial. This is the concentration at this time T. So sometimes they'll ask, what, you know, after 15 minutes, what's the concentration going to be? So that means you would be solving for this. Other times they say, how long will it take for it to go from this to that? Then you solve for T. Okay? Now, so this is second order. Now, what we need to see on this is that this is, both of these equations are complicated forms of Y equals MX plus B. In the first order, this is your Y. This whole log, natural log of A is equal to MX. K is your M. Your constant is your slope, x plus b. Y equals mx plus b. So if you plot these, if it's a first order reaction, the plot is going to be linear. If it's first order. Okay? If you plot the information for a first order reaction into the second order equation, it's not going to come out linear. But if it's a second order overall reaction, then it's going to be this. If you plot it into here, it's going to be linear. Now, if we go all the way back here, let's see. This page that I'm about to show you, y'all, hey, this page that I'm about to show you, just wait, I'm going to show you the link here. Hoover City School main website. Oh, that's not what I want. Spain Park. This is on my webpage, under links, under kinetics. Okay. At the bottom of the notes, they have a similar set of graphs. Oh, really? I just changed it. Okay. So, this page is linked. If you go to the main Steve Hobbs webpage, okay, and go under links, then you're going to see this graph, this page, okay? But they also have at the bottom of the notes on the NIMSY notes that I gave to you, they also have pretty much the same thing. This is just a graphical interpretation of the integrated rate law. Okay? If we have a zero order, for if it's a zero order reaction and you just graph concentration versus time, just the normal rate, concentration versus time, that's going to be a straight line. Okay? So K is going to equal, notice the slope is negative. K is always positive. K is never negative. So you just get the slope, and that's the value of K. So if it's a straight line, just concentration versus time is a straight line, that tells me that it's going to be zero order. Now, if you plot the information, if it's a zero order reaction, and you plot it and tried to put it into this first order, this is what the graph would look like. It's just not linear. If you put it into the 1 over concentration versus time, you get this looking graph. It's just not linear. The linear one tells us the order. So when you come here and you look at the y-axis on this one, it's natural log of A versus time. That tells me, ooh, since this one's straight, that means this is a first order reaction. Then you come down here, and this one, the 1 over concentration, is the straight line. That means that it's second order. That's all you have to know in terms of graphing and interpretation of the graph, is you just need to know that whatever the y-axis is on the straight line one is the one that is going to be, tells you the order. So when you plot your data, okay, so you could take that table of experimental data that they give you, like in the problems we've just been doing, and if you wanted to take the time and plot and get a graph on your calculator, and that's why the notes go say, go graph all these and plot. This is how you plug it into your calculator. Well, if you plotted concentration versus time, just plugged in the values of concentration versus time. Now, they don't really give you time in those, but if they did, okay? Plugged in and then took the log of the concentration versus time, then 1 over concentration versus time. Whichever one came out to a straight line, that tells you the order of the reaction. Now, again, you're never going to have to generate a graph. You just need to be able to interpret. The straight line one is the order. The y-axis determines what it is based upon our integrated rate law. Then the slope of it always gives you K, and you just always know, I can never remember, is it negative K or K? K is always positive. So that's a negative slope, so that means you take the negative of the slope for K. This is a negative slope, which means then I have to take the negative of that to get K. But this is a positive slope, so I don't have to do anything. K is always positive, and it's always the slope, but it's always the positive of the slope, so like absolute value of the slope. Okay? So graphically, we can use the integrated rate law to do this, to figure this out. Now, on a first-order reaction, which they use all the time, this is what just concentration versus time looks like. Why does the rate slow down over time? Isaac, focus. I know you're eating, but keep eating, but just focus. Why? Okay, Reese, why does the rate slow down over time?
Because the concentration starts to decrease, wouldn't it take longer for these,
So what happens to collisions?
They
get fewer and fewer, right? So as time goes, reactions always slow down, because the concentration of the reactants is decreasing, which means the number of collisions is decreasing, so the rate is slowing down. So the rate isn't constant. What we're getting is always an initial rate, the rate at the beginning, not the rate throughout the whole reaction. Now, does anybody know from math, how could I get the rate, say, at this point right here? How could I get the rate of at this time right here, say, even let's just say 10 seconds right here at that dot. What's the rate at 10 seconds? Okay, what's rate equal to? I mean, change concentration over time. Okay? So how do I get... Well, but there's no change. What do we do? Anybody? Okay. Basically, take the derivative of it, which is going to end up being the slope of this line. Okay, so you go and get the tangent to this point right here, and you get the slope of that tangent line. Now, the good news is you're never going to have to do that. Okay? All you have to be able to do is say how you would do it. Okay, so if the question asks, How, at 10 seconds, how could the using the graph, how could the rate of the reaction be determined at 10 seconds? All you have to be able to do is say, take the slope of the tangent line. The slope of the tangent line at 10 seconds is how you calculate the rate. That's called that's the instantaneous rate. That's the rate at any instance. Okay? It's the slope of the tangent line at that point. That's how you get. Notice the rate's going to constantly, the slope would be constantly changing. The rate's constantly changing. The average rate would just be point A and point B, and kind of the line drawn between the two of them. But the instantaneous rate is just the slope of the tangent line at that point. Okay? I never knew an orange could be so entertaining. Mercy. So.
It's a cutie.
Yeah. The whole room smells like it now, and we all want one. Thank God. Okay, so graphically we can look at that. So let's look at a practice problem that does that. Shoot, what happened to it? Okay, I'm going to do one of your practice problems for you.
Can I borrow your charger?
Yeah. Okay. On that packet, on your Chromebook, 2005. Hey, make this bigger. Please. Just move the mouse and it'll get a plus sign down at the bottom. One more. Okay. And now scroll it down just a hair so we can see the top equation. There you go. Perfect. Got to go up a little bit because I got to see the third graph. So, yeah. Okay. So that's, yeah, keep going. I want to see it. Go, keep going up. Keep going up. There you go. I want to see these three graphs. Okay. So, if I'm given this graph, this is the information right here, 2005, Form B. It's on the Chromebook in your packet. So if I'm given these three graphs, how can I tell what the order of the reaction is from the graphs? It's this one. Since it's LNX, it's first order. Okay? If this one had been straight line, it would have been zero. If this had been the one that was a straight line, it would have been second. So that's really all the interpretation of the graph that you need to be able to do. Okay? So the first thing we can do is just from the graph, we can determine the order of the reaction. Okay, so it's first order. So then I know that, okay, this is the equation that I need to be dealing with. Okay? So Catherine, will you just scroll on my computer for me to get to the question? Do we need to go up? Do we need to go down? What do we need to do? Is the question up? Okay, so let's just read this. So the decomposition of gas X to produce gases Y and Z is represented by the equation above. In a certain experiment, the reaction took place. All right, all of a sudden now I have a volume and a temperature, and I have the words gases, I have concentration. So automatically I'm saying somehow or other they're going to ask me something gas law. Okay, data from this experiment were used to produce. So I have my concentrations, and then they give you the natural log, and they give you X to the minus 1, which means, what does X to the minus 1 mean? 1 over X. Okay, move it down, Catherine, please. Okay, so how many moles of X were initially in the flask? How are we going to do that? PV equals NRT. Okay, now, I'm giving you a clue how to do this. How many molecules of Y were produced in the first 20 minutes? That's just going to be a stoichiometry problem. Okay? going through and figuring out and using, how do you go to molecules? What's the conversion factor? Which is known as Avogadro's number. Okay? So instead of going to grams, we go from moles to grams, we go moles to molecules. Okay? So I'm going to let you guys work on that on tomorrow and Friday. Okay? So, but here. So what is the order of this reaction with respect to X? First order. How do we know, Anthony, that it's first order? Because the graph of natural log of X versus time is linear, which indicates it's first order. Okay? So, write the rate law then for this reaction. If it's first order, rate is going to equal K times X to the first. Right? That's all it wants. Rate, we already know the exponent because of the graph. So, calculate the specific rate units. So now you just plug in to get the value of K with units. And then calculate the concentration. Now, calculate the concentration of X in the flask after a total of 150 minutes. So what equation do we need to use now in order to be able to do this? Now, since it's time and it's first order, we're going to have to use this one. Now, in this part, E, you just calculated K. Okay. So now, what do you put in? Go back up, Catherine, go back up to the table now. Okay, so this table. So what do I put in now? So K we just calculated for, based using the other equation, the differentiated rate law. Rate is equal to K times X. So now, though, we have 150 minutes, so obviously that's time. We know K, but what do I put in here? So I go and put initial. What's initial going to be? It's going to be times zero, right? So I put this one in here. So what goes here? That's what you're looking for, right? Now, how do we solve for, so if you have log of A is equal to a number, how do you find what A is? It's going to be E raised to that number. Okay? So you have a log button on your calculator. And right above it, your second function on that natural log button. Now, but remember, there's ln button and there's log button. We want ln button. But right above it, it's e to the x. Right?
Yep.
So, you should be familiar enough with that to where you can solve for that. So, you would simply say e to the x and learn how to put it in your calculator with your Inspire. Most of them, you just plug it in the same way. The simple calculators on your TI-30s, make sure that you know how to plug it in. Okay, so you want to make sure you get e to the 15 or e to the 1.3 times 10 to the minus 5, whatever this turns out to equal. So to get A, you're just going to go e to the x.
When you're plugging in like one of those x values, like it says ln.
No, yeah. Now the reality is that you could plug that in right here and not have to take the log. So you could plug in negative 5.062 right there since they already did it. But I don't know if I would. I tend to always just go here, but that just means I have to hit an extra button on my calculator. Okay? So, okay, that's how we do it. So now I'm going to leave you to finish that. That's kind of one of the assignments for tomorrow and Friday. So let's practice one more, though, where we actually go through and do it. Page 620. Look at number 39. 620, number 39. What the heck? Come on, y'all. All right. Hey, I know that we've gone forever long, but once again, I'm not going to see you for 2 days, so I'm going to try to get my money's worth out of today. Okay? So, when we look at this one, notice here on this in the wording, the reaction given is first order in SO2Cl2. So, most of the time here, when they're giving you the time stuff, they have to tell you the order because you can't just look at it and know. So, they tell me it's first order. So, that automatically tells me, okay, I see time. So, I know I got to use my first order. Now, this time they're using pressure. But remember, pressure is a measure of how close the molecules are. Pressure and molarity, they all, and for gases, molarity and pressure, you can interchange them. So you can just plug this in to that same equation. Okay? So pressure, molarity, it doesn't matter. Just plug it in. So, I know I need to use this. So it says determine the magnitude of the rate constant. So we want to know, okay, now for this time they don't ask you what the units are, but we always want to do units. But for a first order reaction, we know that the units is just going to be per second. Because you got first order means it's molarity on the right, you got molarity on the left, those molarities are going to cancel out. They didn't ask it because they have pressure and the rate, and it's a different unit. So what do we do? How do we find K? Okay? So what goes here?
One,
right? Okay. Well, no. Okay, we got to figure out K. So what's going to go in here? Okay, pick one, anyone. This one is always the initial. This one is any time T. K is going to be a constant at any point, so pick one, anyone. So I would probably pick this one, but if you want, 5,000 is nice and even too. So if you had 5,000... Okay, well, if here, you can put 0.895 in, then the time is going to be 5,000 seconds. So this one has to be here, but the other ones is any time T. Now, sometimes they specify a certain time. You know, other times, you know, you have to, it just, you're either going to be solving for T or A sub T. You're given one, solve for the other, given the other, solve for, you know, so that's the only two things. You almost always have to have the initial concentration. Okay? So plug it in and see what you get. I want to see if you can do it on your calculator. There's one right there. Okay, that's why I want you to practice it. So get it set up to do the algebra, so then you have to do the final calculation. Come on, plug in all the values that you know, and then just arrange, solve for the unknown. Just for the record, this is, I mean, we're talking real chemistry here now. We got concentrations, we got pressures, we got natural logs, we got integrated rate laws. I mean, we have moved up in the world. Hey, you need to feel smart.
Actually, there's a link on your website that says, "Why I will never tell my son he is smart."
I know. Because you want him to constantly keep learning. Because when you get, if you think you're smart, you think you know it all, like my son. That's, yes, that's on the internet as well. You don't know how to do it?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so a lot of y'all are struggling. A lot of y'all are struggling, so let's look at it. Justin. Hurry up, Reese. Okay? So, first thing we have to do is know what everything stands for so we can plug it in. So y'all, come on, 5 minutes left. 10 minutes, five, seven, something like that. Okay? The question is saying, what is the magnitude of the first order? So we're solving for K. That's the first thing we need to know. We're looking for K. So, once I have this, I can pick any time T. Okay? I'm going to pick 5,000. Okay? So I'm going to plug in the concentration as 0.895. So I'm going to say the natural log of 0.895 is equal to negative K times, well, 5,000 seconds is the time I chose, plus the natural log of my initial concentration, which is 1. Okay? So, first thing I would do is I would get what's the natural log of 1? 0. Right? Okay? So this is plus 0. So that means now that natural log is equal to negative 5, so I've got to divide this by 5,000. And take the negative of it. Okay? So now I would just say the log of natural log of 0.895. Now everybody needs to know how to put that in the calculator. So on the TI-30, what's the keystroke? ln 0.895 equals. And then take the negative of that and then divide it by 5,000. And this probably comes out to a negative number. Okay? Log of 0.895 is going to be a negative number. Okay? So you take the negative, it makes it positive because K is always positive. Then you just divide it by 5,000. And so what do we get? 2.21 times 10 to the minus 5.
I used a different equation and I got
2.1. Okay, so if you use 2,500, again, remember we said we're going to get the average value. This is experimental data. 2.18, 2.21, it's 100% correct. Okay? 2 sig figs is 2.2 both times. All right? So, the key to know which equation to use is, are you given time or are you given concentration? The rate law is generally going to be the differentiated rate law, the one we did first. That's the most common, but as soon as time gets to be a factor or a variable, then we go to your integrated rate law. And almost always, they'll tell you in the equation what the order is, or first order, so you know which equation to use. And almost always, they go to first order. Okay? So, tomorrow, we're going to do practice problems. Okay? You probably aren't going to finish. I gave 6 or 8 practice problems. I'm figuring 20 minutes a piece. Okay? So you're probably not going to finish tomorrow on those. So, now listen, just sit down and just wait a second. Friday, you're going to do test corrections. Okay? Those of you that are making up the test, unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to have your test graded because I'm just not going to be here. But, Matt, you're going to be taking the test during that day, so you'll go next door. The rest of you that have already taken it, but you can't do corrections, you just go ahead and use time to work on the practice problems. So whatever we don't finish in practice problems Thursday, do test corrections Friday, and then use the rest of the time to do the rest of the problems, and whatever you don't finish, it's going to be homework. They're due on Monday. I'm checking them on Monday. Okay?